Okay, I think I'm ready to start this program. Good morning, everyone. Thank you all for being here. I'm Ramiro Salazar. I'm the director of the San Antonio Public Library System. It's so good to have you here. We have a very special guest, and he will be introduced shortly. Thanks to Councilwoman Gonzalez. So thank you, Councilwoman Gonzalez, for being here to be part of this program and for introducing our special guest. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank the San Antonio Public Library Foundation and the Friends of the San Antonio Public Library for their continued support of our programs throughout the library system. They've been instrumental in providing additional resources so that we can bring important speakers to the various communities that we serve. We have 27 branch libraries, and we have two more that are under construction and will open later this year. And so this is, we have a large footprint. This is a way we can impact the community in a positive way. This program was also made possible by the National Endowment for the Humanities and the American Library Association. At this time, I would like to welcome and recognize some special guests that we have here today. I'll start with Dr. Diane E. Melby, who's the president of Our Lady of Our Lakes University. Welcome, Dr. Melby. We also have the Friends of the Las Palmas Branch Library, who she, along with her team, worked very hard to support the Las Palmas Branch Library, Delia Trimble. Delia, there you are. Thank you, Delia. Thank you so much. We have Ernest Martinez, representing Jaime Martinez. Jaime has, as you know, been very involved in the community and promoting the Cesar Chavez March and also enlightening the community about Cesar Chavez's legacy. So welcome, Ernest. Thank you. We have Henry Rodriguez, president of LULAC Zapatista Council. There you are. Welcome.
Actually, I'm just the executive director. I'm the gopher, okay?
Whipping boy. Thank you for.
And this is Rosa Estrada. She's our secretary.
Welcome, Rosa. Appreciate having you here. We have Gloria Almaraz also, who's not only a member of the Friends of Las Palmas, she's a local community advocate. She's a freelance writer. She's working on a project and will be published very soon, right? Next week, I believe. Thank you, Gloria. We also have Choco Mesa, who is the Chief of Staff, Councilwoman Gonzalez. Choco. And we're happy again to have Councilwoman Gonzalez here. And I will invite her to the podium very quickly. I'd just like to recognize a couple of staff members, Didi Morganti, Adult Services Coordinator, and our branch manager, Mary Kay Rathke. Where's Mary Kay? Thank you all for putting this program together. And at this time, it's my pleasure to invite to the podium Councilwoman Gonzalez, who has been extremely supportive of libraries throughout the community, especially in her district. And I greatly appreciate her continued support, her efforts to bring additional resources to the library, and for her involvement and engagement to our libraries. Thank you for your service to the community. And at this time, I would like to invite you to the podium.
Good morning, everyone. So happy to see everybody here, all recovered from Fiesta. I know I thoroughly enjoyed my Fiesta week, and Arturo, I hope you had an opportunity to visit some of our great Fiesta events. And so it's fitting that we are here with Arturo Rodriguez to talk about his experiences with United Farm Workers. And I think it's especially fitting that here on the wall behind me, we have some of our great Latino icons. As many times as I've been here, I have to say I've not noticed this wall. And I stand in this area all the time with my children, maybe because we are back here looking at the books. But I think you can see Cesar Chavez and Dolores Huerta and Henry B. Gonzalez back here supporting all of our Latino community. And I think it's really special that you get to be here and have them in the foreground, reminding you always of the work that you're doing and the seriousness and, of course, the commitment to all of our community. Almost, I think, oh no, Dolores Huerta still lives, so I know many of them have passed on, so I think it's so important that we continue to preach the message and to deliver the message. And that's why it is such great honor that I'm here presenting, introducing Mr. Arturo Rodriguez, hometown here in San Antonio. And he was introduced to Cesar Chavez through his parish priests in 1966. He became active with the United Farm Workers Union Great Boycott as a student at our very own St. Mary's University in 1969. At the University of Michigan in 1971, he earned a MA degree in social work. Arturo organizes support for farm workers' boycotts. He began serving full-time with the UFW in 1973 and had a great privilege of having Cesar Chavez as his mentor for 20 years. Arturo Rodriguez has more than 40 years of experience organizing farm workers, negotiating contracts, and leading numerous farm worker boycotts and political drives across North America. Under Mr. Rodriguez, the UFW is working to offer innovative alternative representation through benefits and services, and to extend this representation to workers temporarily brought to U.S. to work in the U.S. agriculture. One of his other goals is preserving America's food supply through a strong and viable agriculture. And I want to say I also had the great honor of walking with Arturo and Jaime Martinez at the march a couple of years ago when he was the Grand Marshal of the parade, and we got to talk a little bit about his history and his time at the University of Michigan, where he was the roommate to Daniel Mesa, who is the husband of my chief of staff. So we know that in Latino communities, we have like about 1 degree of separation between all of us, whether we like it or not, we might all be cousins. So thank you so much for being here, and I'm anxious to hear about the work being done today. And with that, I introduce Mr. Alder Rodriguez. Come on up.
Well, thank you very much, Councilwoman Gonzalez, and I too want to recognize a few folks that are here with us today, in addition to the other folks that have already been mentioned. It always has been a pleasure to come back here to San Antonio, and my wife actually graduated from Arleigh the Lake, so it's great to meet the president. Thank you very much for being here with us. I just want to recognize a woman that's here in the back that's also here at the library, Mary Kay. Mary Kay and her family, we met back almost a little over 40 years ago, and she originally comes from the Detroit area. And when I first joined the organization with the United Farm Workers, I was assigned to work with Richard Chavez, Cesar's brother, there in Detroit, Michigan. And so we were in Macomb County as one of the places, and we got a chance to meet the Radke family there, and they were tremendous supporters. And all of a sudden, I get a call from Mary Kay a few months ago, and hey, I'm here in San Antonio, Las Palmas. And I says, what? And so it's a long ways from Michigan, but the relationship just continued in terms of our work and so forth. And very, very appreciative that Mary Kay reached out, and very appreciative to everybody here at Las Palmas Library, Ramiro and all the rest of the folks for really putting this event together. And then also I have my brother here, Rick, that is here with his wife, Delma, and my sister-in-law, Carmen, that joined us as well, married to my brother, Ray. But it's always a real pleasure coming back here to San Antonio. I mean, when you drive downtown or you go on the freeway and you see Cesar Chavez, and you say, oh man, that's right. And get a chance to come and see the murals here that y'all have done here at the library and all throughout the city. There's definitely events that take place and actions that take place. And I know Jaime, Ernesto's dad, Jaime Martinez, has been, along with a lot of other folks, have really been ensured that the legacy continues to take action here and do and be engaged in different events and be engaged with the community work that's so important. And today marks, I guess, 2 days after the 23rd anniversary of Caesar's passing. So it was Saturday was a traveling day for me this particular time, but I know there was events all across the country that took place and transpired. And I was kind of reminded about things when I turned on the radio this morning, getting into the car on 107.5, the Tejano station, All of a sudden, I turned it on, and Little Joe is being interviewed there. And Little Joe has a long history with us in terms of all the association between the United Farm Workers, Cesar, and Little Joe. And he was playing his song, Las Nubes. And that song was written about farm workers back in the 70s when Little Joe did that particular song. And so I talked with him on the phone. I told him I was going to come here to Las Palmas. I said, oh, that's great. And in fact, next month we honor him at the UFW Gala Awards Dinner on the May the 19th there in Bakersfield, California. So it's funny how all these types of things just come together in terms of what transpires and so forth. But Councilwoman Gonzalez was just sharing a little bit of the story, and I know in 66 I was here. We were born and raised on the south side of town, and we were at St. Margaret Mary's Church. And our local priest, Father Marvin Dörfler, he came, and he, along with a lot of other priests, Father Killian, some of you might remember, Father Cheryl Smith, a number of different Catholic priests, decided to go participate in what was really the first strike here in Texas in the Rio Grande Valley and in Rio Grande City. And it was a melon strike. And so Father Dörfler, along with all the other priests, went down there, and I was kind of surprised. I said, wow, I didn't realize Father would be engaged in some activity like that at that particular time, and wasn't really aware about his knowledge of it. But they went down, and they not only marched on the march, but they also got arrested because of the picket lines and so forth. And he came back, and he told us all about Cesar Chavez, and he said, gosh, this man is really living the faith. This man is really doing what we should all be doing, fighting for social justice, for farm workers, for the poorest of the poor, for the women, the men that harvest our fruits and vegetables and so forth. And so that piqued my interest at that particular time. And when I went to college, and another person that we've been very close to here throughout the years from San Antonio, a woman named Rebecca Flores, who Danny and I both know very well, as well as Choco. But Rebecca, she was now at University of Michigan. And so she came down to recruit Latinos to go up to the University of Michigan. And so the next thing I knew is that Rebecca was down here and said, oh, you gotta go up to Michigan. It's a great place. We need Latinos up there. We're out there recruiting Latinos and so forth. And I had never really been in the snow or anything like that. And I said, well, might as well. And in fact, Our Lady of the Lake, Gil Murillo, who was at that particular time a counselor, I went to Gil because we were also accepted at Our Lady of the Lake. And I asked Gil, Gil, what do you suggest? He says, look, Arturo, all these universities are good universities for the School of Social Work and for community organizing sequence and everything. And he said, but my advice to you, get out of town. And so I said, what? Well, I went and told my brothers, you know what, I'm leaving town. And my dad and mom didn't particularly care for it, but it was probably one of the better decisions I made, because then I got a chance to meet Cesar, Richard personally. When we were at the University of Michigan, I got a chance to meet Danny and so many of our other friends that we still know and hang around with one another. But it really became a transforming part of my life in terms of being able to have that opportunity and to share in that. And because of that, we learned just a tremendous amount. This year, and I'm going to provide to Ramiro, to y'all here at the library, more information on it as we get it, but Rebecca Flores, who worked for the United Farm Workers for many, many years, and she really established the offices here down in the valley, in the Rio Grande Valley, there in different communities there throughout the Rio Grande Valley, San Juan and some of the other places. Her, Juanita Valdez Cox, they are putting together the 50th anniversary celebration of that strike that took place on June the 1st of 1966. So that there's going to be a series of celebrations all throughout the state, actually. And it'll begin on June the 1st in Rio Grande City, where myself and Paul Chavez, one of Cesar's sons, as well as the president of the Cesar Chavez Foundation, will be attending. And I believe Dolores is going to be there with us as well, and joining in with those strikers and those marchers from back in 1966. And then there'll be an event here in San Antonio on Labor Day. The Archbishop agreed to celebrate a special mass here in honor of those 50th, of those strikers and marchers from back during that particular period of time. So that we'll be joining in with that as well. So that there's gonna be a lot of activity this year in celebrating that 50th anniversary strike. And I know that we're gonna be in Austin, Texas at some point, because those marchers went and marched all the way from Rio Grande City to Austin, Texas, and to celebrate and to really talk to folks and make folks aware about the struggle that was going on and taking place with farm workers here in Texas, as well as in California and throughout the nation. And that was, like I said, a very historic point in our history here, but it was also the time when I became aware of what farm workers were doing, and it turned out to become my career and a tremendous opportunity to be able to work with Cesar those 20 years before he passed away on April 23rd of 1993. But one of the things that they really did is that they had this vision, Cesar, Dolores, Richard, and so many of the other founders, to really look upon establishing not just a union, but much more than that, because their viewpoint was is that, look, a farm worker is not just someone that goes and toils in the fields 8 hours a day or 10 hours a day, whatever it might be. They come home and they have their families and the community they live in and everything else. And so that we needed to create not just an organization to deal with the labor issues, but simultaneously to deal with all the rest of the issues. And so because of that, back then, and we celebrate the 50th anniversary for that organization this year, the National Farm Worker Service Center was created, and which was a nonprofit organization. And today it's known now as the Cesar Chavez Foundation, which Paul heads up as the president of that particular organization. But that deals with affordable housing, a huge need for farm workers. And in fact, we've started off in California building that affordable housing and complexes and farm worker communities throughout the state. But now we've developed a number of those affordable housing projects right here in Texas, mostly in the Rio Grande Valley. Two projects, I believe, here in San Antonio. One that last year was named after our father, Rick, and our family's father, who passed away about 3 years ago. And right here on Nacogdoches Road, I believe, is where it's located at. And then there's complexes in Houston and Dallas. There was just a new one opened up in Dallas, Texas here this past week. And so there's a lot of going on to continue to expand that particular work. And then they also deal with radio stations, Spanish-speaking radio stations, because it was always a dream of farm workers to have a way to communicate with themselves and to produce educational programming and that type of thing. So consequently, we put together a series of educational radio stations that run from Washington State into Oregon into throughout California, especially in the major harvesting areas like the San Joaquin Valley, from running from Bakersfield to Sacramento, and then the Salinas Valley, which are the two richest agricultural areas, not only in California, but throughout the nation. And so as a result, we reach out to farm workers every day. And then some educational programming was put into place as well. So that's a very, very important part of the work that we do. In addition, we've set up a whole lot of other organizations. One was set up because farm workers never had access to medical care or medical plans or things of that nature. So we set up the Robert F. Kennedy Medical Plan, and then we set up a pension plan that they can have access to so that they have some funds once they retire. And those two organizations combined we've been able to provide over $500 million, $500 million in benefits to farm workers, whether it be medical or pension benefits and that type of thing. And then the UFW Foundation, which is a sister organization of ours, is another nonprofit that really highlights and focuses in on two areas. One is immigration, which has been one of the issues that we've championed now for the last two decades. We were very much involved in the first immigration reform that took place back in 1986. And now our focus has really been on doing something else to take care of the, well, close to 11 million or possibly beyond immigrants that are in our nation today. And in particular, hone in on farm workers and really figure out what is it that we can do to ensure that farm workers are included in whatever type of immigration reform legislation gets passed and that we're able to be a part of and so forth. In fact, 3 years ago in 2013, when we almost had an immigration reform bill that was actually passed in the Senate, the U.S. Senate, but the House refused to do that, we sat down, the UFW, myself and one of our other folks, sat down with 12 different of the agricultural organizations, national organizations in the country, to sit down and negotiate what the immigration reform package would look like. And Senator Dianne Feinstein, Senator Michael Bennett were very instrumental in working with us and convening. We did all the meetings in Senator Feinstein's offices there in Washington, D.C. And then we worked also with Senator Marco Rubio. At that particular time, he was representing the Republican Party in those negotiations, along with the grower organizations. And so we developed a package there that would have, well, that was completely included all the needs of farm workers, the seasonal nature of farm workers and how they would qualify and everything of that nature. But in the end, you know, we know again that the House wasn't willing to vote on that. But the section that we had negotiated, or I should say the bill that we negotiated, was included in the Senate package as we negotiated it. And it would have become law and so forth. And actually, just on the way over, Senator Feinstein's office called because she wants to reinitiate those negotiations, so that we're going to be looking into that and see what we can come up with. But the UFW Foundation, their primary work is like a sister organization of ours that's down in the Rio Grande Valley, La Unión del Pueblo Entero, LUPE. And those two organizations hone in on becoming experts in the area of immigration, so that we have now offices for the UFW Foundation throughout California and in Arizona, and then we have other offices for LUPE, the sister organization over here in Texas, all throughout the Rio Grande Valley in four different areas in the Rio Grande Valley, where the main office is there in San Juan, Texas. And so they have trained and individuals that are what they are experts in the immigration field, and so they can operate really as quasi attorneys and do all the immigration work. We have the largest number of what they call BI reps, Bureau of Immigration Appeals reps, in the entire state of California. We have 16 of them now, and we have second most highest in the entire nation. And so the Catholic Church is the only one that has any more than what we do at this point in time. And we work very closely with them to cover areas where we're not necessarily present at. But that has become a major focus of theirs in terms of trying to do that. And last Monday, we had a delegation of about a dozen folks, farm workers, that were there in Washington, D.C., joining with everyone else in front of the U.S. Supreme Court to advocate for the Supreme Court to take and make a rapid decision, as well as one that's going to be favorable towards immigrants, and we're very hopeful of that. And the other areas, of course, civic action. The whole aspect in terms of getting people naturalized, first of all, as citizens, and then registered to vote. Every year, you might recall that in 2012, President Obama went to where Cesar Chavez is buried at and where our national offices are at. It's located in a small community called King, California. And he went on October the 12th, and he dedicated that as one of the national monuments in our nation. So it's the 398th national monument, first time ever that a national monument has been named in the country after a Latino, and the first time ever of someone that was involved and engaged in the labor movement as a part of that. And so as a result, when he did that, then the National Park Service now operates and manages at least a portion of what we call La Paz, which is our main headquarters and operations and things of that nature. And so every year to celebrate Caesar's birthday on March 31st, then we do a naturalization service. And so we did that again this year, and we have literally dozens of folks that come. I think this year they were from seven different countries where people were present to be a part of that. And then as soon as they walk out the door, we register them to vote. And so it's an effort to really make sure that we're not only just dealing with the other aspects of someone's life, but that we get them involved in the whole process. And so that they can work on behalf of themselves, they can work on behalf of their families and communities, and be very much engaged. And this year's presidential election has really spurred and increased. I don't know if the same is happening here in Texas, but I know we have, the numbers have gone far beyond what they normally do in terms of folks becoming naturalized and becoming wanting to register to vote and to participate because they feel this presidential election is so critical and so important for themselves as well as for our community, and especially with the immigrant community and all the attacks that have been made against immigrants by the various candidates. So as a result, it's really done exactly what Governor Pete Wilson did back in 1987, passed all these anti-immigrant laws. And because of that, Latinos, at least in California, really kind of moved over, changed their voting patterns and everything else as a result of the actions that Governor Pete Wilson took against the immigrant community, the Latino community in particular, there in the state of California. So it seems like we have the same type of action and activity taking place here with this particular election. And then, of course, you know, the UFW is one of the other pillar organization within what we call our farm worker movement. And so there, you know, we still are engaged in the traditional work that we started off with back in the 1960s. And of course, that's getting contracts with different kinds of employers. And so I was mentioning to a little bit earlier, I think to Daniel Choco, that last week we had an election with a vegetable operation down there in Oxnard, California, that we won 2-1 there. So that was very, very important. But over the last few years, we've been able to make some major gains and significant gains in, for example, the wine grape industry. And so I know that when some of us were going to school back in the 70s and 80s, you know, we had to lay off all the Gallo wines. We couldn't drink Boone's Farm or Strawberry Hill or any of those kinds of wines because they were all made by Gallo. So as a result, we had the big Gallo boycott. And I know on weekends there in Michigan, at least in Ann Arbor, we'd spend Friday evenings picketing in front of all the liquor stores and those types of things. Well, now we have a contract with Gallo. So the Strawberry Hill, the Boone's Farm, all those, you know, they taste a lot better now. It's union workers that are picking them, and they're kosher at this point to be able to drink. But we have the largest winery now in the state of Washington, Chateau San Michel, under contract. We have another good quality wine, Sansupri, there in Napa Valley, that's under contract. And so that's been able to grow within the wine grape industry. In the strawberry industry, we have one of the major employers, Dole, that's under contract now. In the vegetable industry, we've got one of the top five vegetable growers in the nation, John DiArrigo, under contract, and a host of others. The largest dairy in the western United States, Three Mile Canyon, is located in Hermiston, Oregon, that particular area, and then several other particular areas, major areas, where we've been able to make significant gains. I know in the last 3 years, in particular, the tomato industry, the fresh tomato industry there in the northern San Joaquin Valley has been our target and will be our target again this year. But where we've made the most gains, and I know they sell them here in San Antonio, so this is the one, besides the wines, the one label you can look for on mushrooms. Do people like mushrooms? How many of y'all eat mushrooms? Yeah, good. But look for Monterrey mushrooms, the packaging for there. I know they carry them in a lot of the stores. They have several different operations there in the state of California. And there we've been able to make the most gains for farm workers. I think their wages average, because they're year-round workers, anywhere from $35,000 to $40,000 a year, which for a farm worker, that's a lot of money in comparison to what where they started at and most people being at minimum wage and everything else. And then they've got paid holidays. They got more paid holidays than actually we do in their contracts that they have, and they've got paid vacations and a medical plan and a pension plan and some other benefits. But the most important thing is that they've developed a relationship there with Shaw Kazemi, who's the employer, that really does create a mutual type of and a beneficial collaborative type of relationship there with the employer. And so it works very, very good in that respect. And we're very much proud in terms of what's been able to be done there. And then in addition to our collective bargaining, we do a lot of political and legislative work as well. And in particular in legislation, we see a lot of things, you know, are very difficult to get at the bargaining tables, but we can legislate these changes. So for example, because farm workers have been excluded from the National Labor Relations Act, they were excluded from the Farm Safety Act that was passed back in 1938, so that as a result, most laws that cover other workers throughout the United States do not cover farm workers. So for example, unemployment insurance, minimum wage, worker comp, all those particular laws are just spotty throughout the nation. So one of the major areas has been the issue of pesticides, which impacts not only in the farm worker and their families, but just as much as the consumer. And that's very much a part of what happens and what transpires with the agricultural products. And so that we worked very closely this last year with the administrator of the Environmental Protection Agency, Gina McCarthy, from the Obama administration, to sit down and try to, for the first time at least, deal with the issue of pesticides and try to ensure that what covered and what protected other workers in other industries that utilize pesticides and the pesticide manufacturing and so forth would also be beneficial to cover farm workers. And as a result of that, we were able to, this last year now, get the same, almost the same coverage for farm workers, and we've been fighting decades for that, that really took and protected workers in other countries and throughout the United States in regards to the use of pesticides. Another one was heat. You know, it's very similar to here, all the Rio Grande Valley, everybody knows how hot it gets during the summertime. Well, that's the same thing over in the San Joaquin Valley and the Coachella Valley, and sometimes Oxnard area and so forth, but they're more on the coast. But throughout the San Joaquin and Coachella Valley, the Coachella in particular, the temperatures during the summertime range anywhere from 110 to 120 out there in the agricultural communities. And the San Joaquin Valley, it ranges anywhere from 100 to 110 on typical days starting next month all the way through the month of September. Well, we found, and it very well may exist here in this state as well, but we found literally every year there were farm workers that were dying because of heat exposure. And again, it was another area of work that we had fought now for decades to try to set aside or to develop, I should say, laws that would protect workers when they were working out in the hot sun and that type of thing. And so in particular, there was one particular case that really kind of helped spark, and it was extremely unfortunate and it was a real tragedy, but there was a woman named Maria Isabel Vasquez Jimenez. She was a young 17-year-old immigrant that came over from Oaxaca to work in the fields, and she had her mom and her siblings still over in Oaxaca, so she had to come here to raise money. She didn't have papers, so she had to pay someone to bring her across the border, several thousand dollars. And she went and lived with her uncle, which was in Northern California, up just south of Sacramento in a little community called Lodi, which is a wine grape area, and so forth. And so it was only her third day of work at this particular company that she was at, and the temperatures were well over 100 degrees. And so she was a very petite woman. I think she weighed like 95 pounds. She was pregnant. And so she was working on that particular day. And about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, she was exhausted because she was carrying these 25 pound boxes of grapes back and forth, up and down the rows to be able to complete her quota. And the foreman was there watching to see if she was doing what she was supposed to be doing, if she was doing it with quality and everything else, and ensuring that she was meeting the quotas that was necessary. Well, by 3 o'clock in the afternoon, she just collapsed right there in the field. And the foreman at that particular crew, instead of calling 911, instead of calling someone to come and take care of her, they just drug her under a set of vines over there and left her there the rest of the afternoon. And they put, you know, wet cloth on her forehead and thought, okay, that's it. That's all we need to do. At the end of the day, when the harvest was done, on that particular day, they took her along with the others that go in this particular van to take them, transport them home that day. And the van had been sitting out in the hot sun, so it was like a furnace getting inside that van. They got inside, and shortly afterwards, her boyfriend, Florentino, told the van driver, hey, look, Maria Isabel's very sick. We need to take her to a clinic. So the driver contacted the foreman. The foreman said, okay, but told Florentino that whatever you do, don't tell her she was working in the fields. Say that she got exhausted while she was out exercising, out jogging. And so they got her over to the clinic a few minutes later, and by the time they examined her and looked at her, her body temperature was 108 degrees. And so consequently, literally, her organs internally had burnt up, and by the next day she passed away. And that was, for at least in terms of publicizing what's happening to farm workers and folks that were exposed with heat exposure and so forth, it helped us do a tremendous amount. The uncle, I'd never met him before. We talked on the phone, his name was Doroteo Jimenez. And Doroteo also didn't have papers. And he lived off of farm workers. He had his family, and I went to visit him oftentimes there in their apartment up there in Lodi. And the first time I talked to Florentino, I asked him, Florentino, what do you want to do? Because we really didn't feel like it was our decision to make. It had to be their decision if they wanted to take some type of action or not. And his response, Doroteo's response was that, look, no quiero que ella se murió en vano. I don't want to be her death to be in vain. And so we talked about, well, are you ready to go and to be public about this and to put the pressure and everything else? And he said, yes. And so in the next few days, we planned a march. They went from Lodi to Sacramento. We met at the Catholic Church there in Lodi, and that became our starting point. And I forget, I guess it was about a 50-mile trek that we had to do over a few days. But Doroteo made the decision that he was going to lead the march. Now, again, I mean, we might think, oh, well, there's nothing wrong with that. That's not going to impact on him, and yet it did. Because the moment that he put himself in the public eye, now all of the agricultural community knew who Doroteo was. He was immediately blackballed. He lost his job at the company where he was working at, and he couldn't get a job in other areas, with other employers within the area. So now he has to commute every day from Lodi to Santa Rosa, to the wine grape country, to be able to get employment because of the decision he made. The good thing was is that this resulted in the first regulation that we could get around the issue of heat there in the state of California. After decades of fighting for that, those kinds of protections for the workers. And then this past year, we were successful in working with Governor Jerry Brown and his administration to pass a heat regulation that's now in existence, where that when the temperatures rise to be 90, 95 degrees, at that particular point, workers get 10-minute breaks every 2 hours that are paid for by the employer. They get additional water. All the supervisors are supposed to be trained on what actions to take place when somebody becomes ill there in the fields and those types of things. So there's been huge gains that have been made. Unfortunately, it takes those types of tragedies to really highlight in terms of what's taking place. But the beauty of it is that Doroteo's wish was granted as a result of the hard work that he did, despite the difficulties that he still goes through. And then there's, again, been a lot of other areas of work with legislatively. This year, our big focus in the state of California, because we feel we have to set a precedence here in the United States, is for farm workers to be able to be protected under overtime laws. They don't have the protections like other workers. We're the only group of workers that do not get overtime after 8 hours. In fact, in most states, there's no overtime coverage at all, so that you can work 10, 11, 12 hours, whatever it is that you, the employer wants you to, you're obligated to work that with no extra additional pay. So we felt that we, many years ago, back in 1975 in California, we were able to get overtime after 10 hours. Now our fight is to really get overtime after 8 hours of pay. And we figured if we can establish that there, then hopefully we can be able to do something nationally, especially if we get an administration that's favorable, that's willing to take those types of risks in terms of going out and doing that. And so that's, again, a key part of our work is all of the legislative and political work, that we can do things that it's not because we have a contract with those workers, but we feel it's the right thing to do, so that we work on behalf of all farm workers, regardless of whether they're union members or not union members. To us, that's minimal. I mean, it's important, and we'd like that, but we feel it's more important to be doing this kind of work on behalf of everybody to better their lives and so forth. And again, that's where our roots are. That's what Cesar and all the other founders, they felt was very important, is that we need to take action beyond what the contracts might be that we have. We need to take action on behalf of all the workers. The new area that we're really exploring and excited about today is that, you know, agriculture's changed dramatically over the last 50 years since we began. And so it used to be that all of the fruits and vegetables, or the majority of fruits and vegetables that we consume here in the U.S., as adults, as children, and so forth, were all produced here in the U.S. That's no longer the case. Probably at least 55% of the fruits and vegetables that we get today are produced someplace overseas or out of the country, whether it be Mexico, whether it be some other place. And a lot of that's happened because you have one, you've had tremendous retailer, what we call retailer consolidation, so that you have the huge stores, Walmart being number one. And then you have the Krogers, and they've bought up all these other smaller chains and so forth. I'm not sure where HEB ranks, but they've got to be up there as well in terms of their consumption and their sales and that type of thing. Costco and other retailers like that. So the top five retailers probably take in about 40 to 45% of supermarket sales throughout the nation and throughout the world in many particular cases. And so consumers, we being who we are, you know, we got used to, as things began to change, saying, you know what, I don't want table grapes just when the Coachella Valley harvest used to start. And that was in May down there in Southern California. And then we'd have table grapes from May, the end of May, all the way through October. But we finally said, no, I want table grapes all year round. And so then we started getting table grapes from Chile, and Chile would then bring them in January and February and March. And then there was that gap between April and May before the Coachella. So now we get additional table grapes coming in from Sonora, Mexico. So half of our year is really table grapes coming in from other parts of the world other than what we produce here in the U.S. And so that's happening with all the various crops. Avocados, I went to HEB with one of my brothers, with Carmen's husband, yesterday, and 45 cents an avocado. And that was great. I said, oh, let's buy them. And then we looked and said, yeah, they're from Mexico. But they make, in Michoacan, as those of us that are come from that particular area know, that they probably have the best, one of the best varieties of any place that you can find in the world in terms of avocados and so forth. So because of all that, we said, you know, it can't be a union. We can't take a union and establish a union in Mexico, or we can't establish a union in some other country. We have to develop organizations and create organizations that can operate and function in other countries, but at the same time can raise the standard of living for farm workers in those areas, as well as continue working with farm workers in the United States. Because there's just a huge gap. A couple of months ago, one of the areas that we're working in as a result of that is Nicaragua. And so we went to visit one of the plantations there called La Revancha, a coffee plantation, located there in Nicaragua. And the salary for those workers is the equivalent of $6 a day here in the United States. So you can't even begin to compare. I mean, even the worst of situations doesn't matter there. I went to visit the place where, and this was a better housing area than where most live, there on the plantation itself. And you know, you go to where their homes are at, and a whole home would be, say, from this pillar to the wall, and maybe to where this cabinet is right here. That would be a whole house for a family of 3, 4, 5, 6, or whatever. It's all just one room, and it may have some type of divider. I know in this one particular house that we were in, and the family was very proud when we were there visiting with them, but they had a curtain over a particular wall space there that really served as their bedroom. All dirt flooring, but they were happy. And the one thing that was so exciting about is that they were able to put a division between the kitchen area and where they slept and where they ate at. And they thought that was great, but still the stove was right inside the house. So it's a stove that's made out of earth that they put together, like adobe, that type of thing. And so all the smoke stays right inside the house. So the children, everybody, the family's exposed to that the whole time. But we felt that if we're gonna continue to be able to improve conditions of farm workers here in the U.S., we also have to begin doing the same thing on a much more global basis. And the retailers, they're demanding the same type of thing, because they're always worried about food safety issues. They're worried about legal issues that they're confronted with, and contamination, those types of things. And so we felt, well, this is a way that we could be of value to the retailers, because where we have our strength is with that worker support and the trust that workers, farm workers, have in what we do and what our organization means to them. So it's a whole new area that we're learning every single day in terms of what we have to do. We were just last week actually meeting with an employer that's based here in San Antonio that produces the little wine grape beds and the small cherry tomato grapes and so forth. It's called Nature Sweet. And so if you ever see Nature Sweet around, I know they're excellent. But they have operations all throughout Mexico in several different places, and now they just opened up an operation in Arizona. So we're working very closely with them and ensuring that those operations, that we help them train the labor force to deal with food safety issues, to deal with productivity issues, to deal with all those different areas of importance, so that, and at the same time, get economic gains for those workers, whether they be in Mexico or whether they be here in the U.S. And we can do that under the guise of a nonprofit organization, so that we're developing those nonprofits now and other types of organizations, so we can be able to engage in that particular way with workers from wherever they might be throughout the globe, throughout the world, and that we deal with this global agricultural industry that now is really in effect here in the United States today, and that consumers here are impacted by it. So there's a whole lot more to share with folks, but I wanted to just comment on some of those things, and then I think, Mary Kay, do we have time for questions? So that open it up for questions, but that gives you a little bit of background in terms of some of the work that we continue to be engaged in, that we're looking forward to, that we're planning for the future, and so that we can maintain our relevancy as an organization that not only benefits farm workers, but benefits those others that are part of the food supply chain, whether it be consumers or retailers or growers. I mean, we're just learning a whole new way of doing things that frankly, when I came into the organization, I never thought I would be sitting down with a grower talking to them about all these kinds of things and working things out, but that times have changed, and we've got to be able to do those kinds of things in order to ensure the progress for consumers and for others here throughout the United States today. But yeah, I'd be happy to try to answer any questions that folks might have, or something that I said that wasn't very clear or whatever. Yes?
I'm just wondering, is anything around San Antonio area that's
Good thing you asked that question. Thank you very much. So, Ernesto, do you want to say something about the organization y'all have?
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, first, we just finished up the 20th anniversary of the Cesar Chavez March for Justice in San Antonio, which is co-sponsored with the city of San Antonio. This year, our Grand Marshal was Shirley, Councilman Shirley Gonzalez. So we do have, So the last 20 years, we've been marching to preserve the life and legacy of Cesar Chavez, and it's very important that we do that for education outreach. But also important is on the education side of the scholarships. We have a scholarship program that we have. We awarded $27,000 in scholarships. I would encourage you to visit our website, ceclef.org. You see me afterwards, I'll give you a card. And encourage the students to apply. The scholarship is growing. There are volunteer opportunities at the Cesar Chavez Center, located at 1504 East Commerce. So there's a lot of opportunity to participate. And here in San Antonio, I think we've done a pretty good job of preserving the life and legacy of Cesar Chavez, an American hero and role model for all our students. So if you want to participate by volunteering and doing something in a local library, visiting a school, we welcome that, definitely. So I'll give you my name and number afterwards. Come see me. We weren't happy to plug you in.
Thank you very much, Ernesto. Yeah. And then in addition, as I mentioned, we're going to get information here for the library, for Councilwoman Gonzalez, about the event that will be taking place here on Labor Day at the Cathedral, where the Mass will be held in honor of those strikers, the 1966. And also, I might ask, before you leave today, just take a moment to fill out this card. If you don't have one, if you didn't receive one, just raise your hand, and we'll be happy to get one to you. But we're more interested in your name and your address, especially your email address. Because again, one of the things that we've changed over the years is that when I came into the organization, I mean, the only way that we were able to do things was do picket lines in front of, I remember going out at 4 a.m. in the morning and picketing here at the produce terminal, and my dad would be wondering, where are you going at this hour? And then after that, we have to go to school at St. Mary's and continue all that work and so forth. But today, I mean, with technology being what it is, I mean, we do a lot of work via email, via Facebook, via all the different types of technology that exist. And so Twitter and so forth. And thank goodness we have a very talented staff that really knows about all these kinds of things and can do it. So I'd ask you to please fill it out, and you could give it either to Mary Kay in the back of the room there. Mary Kay, just raise your hand. Either Mary Kay or myself, and we'll be happy to take the cards. Was there another question? Yes.
In how many states is the UFW functioning?
So let me just take it from the farm worker movement. We're operating today in Washington State, Oregon, all throughout California, Arizona, New Mexico, Texas, Washington, D.C. We have our offices there as well. Those are the primary areas where we're at right now. And we'll soon be in Colorado, be moving up there. We're already doing work with them over there, but we'll have offices there and so forth in that particular area. Yes, yes, Ernesto.
Arturo, first, congratulations on the progress, and thank you for all that you do on behalf of the farm workers. I'm curious to know about the progress of the national holiday. I know a few years ago there was some momentum being built with Santana, some other people that came out to advocate for the national holiday. Is there anything we can do locally? What are some of the things happening there for the national holiday?
You know, I mean, thank you for the question, Ernesto. You know, that's, for us, it's not issues that we directly have gotten involved in a lot, you know, because frankly, there are so many folks that have been responsible throughout the decades of really creating and building the organization that we have today, that we oftentimes, you know, feel a little embarrassed about all the focus being put on Cesar, or Dolores for that matter, or some of the other leaders. And that, you know, I mean, we've always had a very vibrant group of people here in San Antonio, for example, that the recognition will never be there, at least on a national basis, for those individuals. So there have been groups that have worked on that. We don't, to be very honest with you, we don't spend our time and resources on trying to really make that happen. Because in politics, I mean, and Shirley knows as well, and others I'm sure, is that, you know, everything counts. And so the moment you ask for this, then you're indebted to them. And so we'd rather go to the national politicians, whether it be the president or anyone else, and ask them to do things that are really benefit farm workers directly or benefit our communities that we're working in and things of that particular nature. So we're fighting for immigration. Hopefully with the new administration, we'll be fighting for overtime. We got pesticides this last year. We're always looking for those kinds of issues, and we don't want to be trading with them the issue of a holiday. And so if that's something that happens, it's going to happen because other people want to see it happen, and they'll create the kind of movement and that's necessary to do that and to figure those things out. But not that it's not important. It's very important. We just don't want to use our chips, the few we have, in that particular way, and try to bargain with as much as we possibly can. Other questions that folks have? Yes, sir.
Yeah, is there like a direct program for the immigrants and housing to kind of connect that together?
You know, we, the Cesar Chavez Foundation, as I mentioned, is the one that focuses in on affordable housing. They've developed and built about 5,000 units now in the different states that I've mentioned, Washington, Oregon, California, New Mexico, and Arizona, and Texas. And so, you know, anybody is welcome to come to our website and to see where those are located at and to apply to live there, and especially if they're in need. I mean, those are the ones, the folks that we really try to help out a lot within the various communities. And so that probably would be the best way right now, at least, to connect, is going to the Cesar Chavez Foundation website and seeing where those communities are located at and working in that particular way.
Thank you.
Yes, quite welcome. Any other questions that folks might have? Yes, sir.
So in the area of immigration, is the organization doing anything for the illegal immigrants that are farm workers to help them get citizenship or perhaps some work permits that are not available yet or now?
Yeah, that's, it's a critical issue for us because the reality is that farm workers today, the demographics have changed since many of us worked in the fields or our families worked in the fields and so forth. In the 60s, it was still, you know, largely a population that was born and raised here in the United States, whether it was African Americans or Latinos or Anglo-Americans, there were still lots of folks from the Dust Bowl days that were still working in ag and so forth. Since then, by the 1970s, it was more and more immigrants coming in because folks here in this country, especially after immigration laws were passed, decided, you know, now that I have the opportunity, I'm gonna move into some other kind of industry. And so consequently, you know, probably about 70 to 80% of our workforce are undocumented immigrants today that work in ag. And so we're constantly looking for ways. That's why we spend so much time and energy really on doing this. And 2 weeks ago, Hillary Clinton, called and asked me to chair their immigration policy committee, so that I'm doing that on a national basis, working with our folks, and we have about 75 other organizations throughout the country that are part of this national policy committee. And it's funny you ask that because this afternoon I head to Austin and we have our first immigration policy committee meeting that'll take place and looking at that. So we're very much looking at what the policy is, but at the same time to see what we can do immediately to deal with those particular issues. And the UFW Foundation, that is their primary work, is to try to figure out what we can do. In fact, one of the orders that went under President Obama's executive action order last year was to deal with the parents of young folks that were born here in the United States. And there was a woman that I was with a week ago, last Sunday, in Delano, California. We were marching there for overtime pay and to also for immigration reform. And she was telling me her story, Maria, that she is a woman she had 12 children, two of them passed away. She came here to this country without any papers. So, and two of her daughters stayed back in the two of her children stayed back in Mexico. And so there's been And prior to that time, two other children of hers were back in Mexico as well, passed away. She couldn't go there. That's why we decided to be a part of the Immigration Policy Committee with the Secretary Clinton's campaign and to do everything we can to push that. The one, you know, depending on what happens on the elections, the one commitment that Secretary Clinton has made is that within the first 100 days of her administration, that would be one of the legislative areas that she would definitely file legislation on within that first 100-day period. So again, that's why we're part of this, to help develop that policy, to put that legislation together, and to have it ready in the event that we can utilize it. Thank you. Yes, Henry.
Need some information in terms of, that we can use. See, our national convention is coming up in July for LULAC. And we want to push some resolutions. One having to do with the immigration reform package, then that farm workers be included. The other one would be for farm workers other than the U.S. of A. And so that we can have that information and really put something that's really, that makes sense, and we can push it at the national level.
Before you leave, Henry, why don't you give me your card and
let me make
a note, because it just so happens that we have, every 4 years, we have our convention with farm workers, and we're having it in Bakersfield, California on May the 20th, 21st, and 22nd. And I will send you some of the resolutions that we'll be utilizing during that convention.
Fantastic, and that's the delegates. We can do our own.
Yeah, great.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Any other questions? So I want to, again, thank you very much. All the folks here from Las Palmas Public Library, Mary Kay, thank you for reaching out and not keep maintaining that, as they call it, for organizers, they say fire in the belly, that you have to maintain that passion about an issue that you're very much interested in and a part of and so forth. And thank you so much for not losing that in any particular way. And certainly we want to thank everyone that's here today that have joined with us, Councilwoman Gonzalez and Our Lady of the Lake, all the other friends that we have here, Danny and Choco and Ernesto and my family and so forth. So thank you and all the best. Si se puede.
Thank you, Mr. Rodriguez. Thank you for your leadership, and thank you for the good work and services the United Farm Workers of America provide to our farm workers. I was very enlightened by your comments and remarks. I do want to share that your remarks will be shared, and at this time I'd like to recognize Nowcast and Charlie Ann Lucas, who is the executive director. Nowcast is a nonprofit entity that provides public information regarding public policy, events and activities, and information that's important to the community. We partner with them because libraries, as well as Nowcast, believe that we can empower the community by providing information and by educating the community on issues that are important. And so certainly your remarks today are extremely important, and they will be shared with hundreds and thousands of other individuals through Nowcast. So thank you, Charlotte, and also for being here. Thank you, Councilwoman Gonzalez, for being part of our program. And also, as a closing remark, I wanted to indicate two things. First of all libraries in Texas are official voter registration sites. So at the time that an initiative in Texas is put forth by the United Farm Workers of America regarding voter registration, please keep in mind that all of our public libraries, we have 29 throughout the community, and we'll have two more by the end of the year. Voter registration sites, most of them are voter polls as well. So I wanted to share that with you. And in closing, thank you all again. I want to join Mr. Rodriguez in thanking all of you for being part of this program. We have some refreshments, so please enjoy. Thank you.